So some of these benign tumors, that is papilloma, lipoma, adenoma, fibroma, hemangioma, neurofibroma, these are commoner. So we discuss one by one in the detail. So first we discuss the papilloma. So papilloma, the character of papilloma is that this papilloma mostly means all the papillomas are common, commonly benign, and these may be sessile or pedunculated. Sessile means when there is no base is there, means the wide base is there, no pedicel is there from which they are attached, no root means or the flattened. And the pedunculated means when the mass has one pedicels, one root. Mostly occurs in the skin, but few papilloma may present inside the body also. It contains all the layer of the skins. It contains the blood vessels. It contains the lymphatics. So the various categories of the papillomas we discuss. When it derive from the epidermis, when it derive from mucous membrane, when it derive from wall of any duct, or when it arrive from the any cyst. So this squamous cell type papilloma usually that first we discussed from the when it develop from the epidermis. So the epidermal papillomas mostly develop in the skins that are two types, one from the squamous cell and one from the basal cells. These are the layer of the skins. So from where it originates? So squamous cell type are the four types. Some congenital types, infective papilloma or infective warts, soft papilloma or keratinophobes. So the congenital one is present since birth, and it may be sessile or may be pedunculated. It has all the layer of the skin along with the blood vessels and the lymphatics. So just overgrowth of the skin and very slow growing. Thus, all the features are the benign tumors. The infective papillomas are the papilloma who develops due to any infection of In due to any infection, that is mostly viral infection called human papilloma virus. So these human papilloma virus develops the infective warts. These warts most commonly found on the hands and soles, sometimes on the genitalia also. And these due to derive from the squamous cells, that's why these warts are very hard. So when a infective wart present on the sole, then it is very difficult to differentiate it from the corn. In that differential diagnosis of corn, plantar corn, we have discussed it. That is a hard swelling, hard mass, which is sessile and shows all the characters just like the corn, but it doesn't have a root. That's why that differentiate from the corn, because corn is just like the diamond shape. But these are only flattened but hardened. That soft papilloma present over the skins. And keratin horn, these are usually developed in that old people's, means in the older age people's, when that due to keratinization, it becomes very hard. Just like horn-like structure, very hardened structures due to deposits or deposition of the keratin. So these are the papilloma developed from the squamous cells. Other papilloma developed from the basal cells are the senile warts. So these are the small pedunculated sessile lesions which may be multiples and mostly present in the older age group. That develops on the around the neck, face, trunk, armpits, just like the overgrowth of the skins. You can see in the next pictures. Yeah, so these type of the papilloma are that these type of the basal papillomas, just like the skin overgrowth. Okay, and this is the infective wart. This is the wart. These are also warts. So these are hardened structures. Next, the papilloma developed from the mucous membranes. So these are from three types, which they, when they derive from the squamous cells, when they derive from transitional cells, and when they derive from the columnar cells. Usually these type of the lipoma are present inside, these type of the papilloma are present inside the body, that in the oral cavity, the tongue, in the cheeks, and the lips, and the esophagus. These are just like that overgrowth of the mucous membranes having the very good supply of the blood and as well as the lymphatic supply. The transitional epithelium of the urinary bladder and the ureter, when develops the mass, that is that papilloma of the mucous membrane. And the columnar epithelium of the colon, rectum, stomach, small intestine, these small intestine. So these kind of that papillomas, when overgrowth having the mucus developed from the mucous membrane, so all these secretes lot of the mucins, that third of the mucus they secretes. And these type of the papillomas growth, and then they present as the polyps. So these polyps are nothing, just are the papillomas which we derive from the mucous membrane of the columnar epithelium inside the rectum and colon and the stomach. Usually these are solitary in singles, but sometimes multiple polyposes may be there inside the large intestine and the colon. So these conditions may be the pre-malignant conditions. Present of so much polyps in any patients may indicate that patient that conditions in the later stage may become the malignant. So that may convert into the malignant. Other conditions would be discussed from that epidermis papilloma, they never become malignant. But these papilloma from the mucous membrane, these has tendency to become the malignant. The papilloma derived from the ducts, these are from the breast tissue, that ductal cells are ducts are there, let's see, fresh ducts are there with the milk is secreted. So in that ducts some growth is developed, that is soft, and these growth called papilloma of the ductal papilloma. And sometimes the cysts of that ovary, that cystic where the is secreting the hormones and hormones and secretions. So from that cysts of that ovary and the breast, the papilloma also can develop. So now we discuss the treatment of all these type of the papilloma. So most of the papilloma develop from the epidermis. The treatment is mostly due to the cosmetic reasons, because they don't harm, they don't have the malignant changes. So these conditions, the patient seeks for the management only for the cosmetic purpose. No other complications may be present. Except in that that infective warts, in that infective warts, it become very contagious and it spreads from one body parts to other body parts. So that's why it requires some antiviral therapy. And if it is not controlled by this, then surgical excision is the better option for all the kind of the papillomas. Inside the body, if there is a, just like in the mucous membrane, tongue, cheeks, or if any soft lump that I feel that this, that may be the mucous papilloma. So in that cases also the excision and the histopathological examination is very much essential because to rule out that any to rule out any malignant changes. So surgical biopsy is the choice of the treatment in these kind of the papillomas. You can see these pictures. Next is the adenomas. Adenomas are that benign tumors developed from the glandular tissue. So this that's why it's mostly present in that glandular structures where the secretions are the secretory functions are there. Most of that these glands, salivary glands. So in the pictures you can see this is the parotid glands. So this is the tumor of the parotid glands. These conditions are well encapsulated, means they are inside any capsule. No features except the swelling, and later on when the swelling attain a big size, so in that condition the pressure effects may be present. Means whenever it attain a big size, when then it's compressing the nearby structures, that nerves, arteries and veins. So features related to these type of that, these may present. So next, this adenomas present from that colon, that mucous membrane of that colon. So there's the polyps, and that just like in that papillomas. So these masses are developed in the intestine and rectum. These have the tendency to have the to be the malignant changes. So some the other secretory organs that like breast, prostate, salivary glands and the endocrine glands may develop these kind of the benign tumors, adenomas. So the features of the adenoma are that they attain the size, and the important thing is that these kind of the adenoma benign tumors have tendency to changes into the malignant. So that is the important feature. So if any kind of the lump you feel that is adenoma, you must excise and send it to biopsy for that confirmation, so that it has any malignant changes or not. Sometime that when the adenomas has some additive tissue, just like if it is more fibrous tissue, then it is called fibroadenoma. When the more cystic tissue, then it is called cyst adenoma. So fibroadenoma is common in the breast, and cyst adenoma is common in the ovary, pancreas, parotid glands, and the kidneys. The treatment is the choice of treatment is the excision is the only way. Fibroma, these are the very rare kind of the benign tumors which has the very good amount of that fibrous tissue, the fibroblast in these in that masses. So that's why they are very they become very hard, or they become the soft. So when it contain more collagen, then that type of the fibroma become hard. When it has only that fibroblast cells, no collagen is developed, so that is called softer fibroma. These fibroma may combine with other mesodermal tissues such as fat, muscles and nerves. So these are found in that soft palate, in the mucous membrane, that buccal cavity, and some other body parts also. So the complete excision is the also only mode of treatment for these kind of the benign tumors. This is the next, the lipoma. That is the most common benign tumor found in the human beings. That is the lipoma. This is composed of fat cells, and these all the fat cells are means healthy fat cells, adult fat cells, not immature fat cells. it occurs in anywhere in the body, that is called the universal tumor or ubiquitous tumor. That lymphoma are also called as universal tumor or ubiquitous tumor because they can be present in all over the body, means in any part of the body. But the most common sites are the trunk and the upper limb, back of neck and the limbs. There are three types of the varieties are encapsulated, diffuse variety and the multiple lymphoma. Although all the benign tumors are the encapsulated, but that is the basic difference between the these benign and malignant tumor. So that encapsulated variety means they are well capsulated. The capsule is very hard. That's why all the fat tissue is remain inside and just no adhesion to the surrounding tissue is there because that of the capsule. That's why the lymphoma always has the mobility. It never fixed to the surrounding structure. It always has the mobility. That slip sign is always present in that lymphoma. Next variety is the diffuse variety. Diffuse variety is these type of the lymphomas are the lobulated, means that the fat cells are condensed in the form of the lobules and it has very thin capsules. That's why it's called diffuse, because the fat it deposited in a certain part, but it has not very good capsule around this. So little diffusely they arranged. It has not very well defined margins. That's why it's called the diffuse variety, and this is also called the pseudo lymphomas because they don't they have not the exact all the features of that benign lymphomas. These are the collection of the fat cells, but there is the capsule is very thin. So these are also called the pseudo lymphomas. These are mostly present in the around the neck and in the person who are the alcoholics patients usually have this kind of the problem. Next is the multiple lymphoma. This is the condition where the multiple small lymphomas are present inside they are various in numbers, not a single number, but these all are well capsulated and lobulated. The margin are well defined, all are the mobile, all are the maybe that mobility little depends on that site of the lymphoma. If lymphoma is superficial, so it is more mobile. When it is deeper structure, so the mobility will be less, but all are mobile and not fixed to the surrounding structures. So these conditions, the multiple lymphomatosis, diffuse lymphomas and well encapsulated lymphomas, these are three categories of the lymphoma. Next, these are the few complications which may happen in the lymphoma, as means the fate of the lymphoma, how the lymphoma can be changes in the future. So first, it may get degenerate, okay, and second, the saponic, because there is so much fats, so that fats may be got saponifications, the gut may dissolves and that form a cavity of the fluid which can be infected and form any abscess. Third, it may calcify and become very hard. And fourth thing, it may have some malignant changes or the sarcomatous changes. Because if it is developed from that connective tissue, then that is called the sarcomatous changes. Means that it may has the convert into the malignancy. But the chances very few, 1 or 2-3% or only chance is there when a lipoma can convert into that malignant malignancy. It remains the benign throughout the life, but the calcification is little more common. When the lipoma remains for longer time, 10 to 15 years, then it can be calcified. The characteristic of the lipoma is these are very slow growing. So first a few months, if the person is very obese, so the person may not feel that muscles, because if the skin has a thick layer of the subcutaneous fat, so that identification is later on. Maybe the later the patient may not identify in the early stage, later stage the patient may identify. And these are just the few anatomical situations where lipoma can be present: subcutaneous, subfacial, intermuscular, subserosa, submucous, intraarticular, subsynovial, periosteal, extradural, intraglandular. So these are the different sites where the lipoma, you know, that's why the lipoma is called the universal tumor, because it can present in so much various conditions in our body. The subcutaneous lipoma is most common. So we just discuss in the detail, and we just discuss it in the detail. So first, the pathology, you know that this is the benign tumor of the fat cells. All the fat cells are the healthy fat cells, just they are aggregated at the same place and encapsulated with a fibrous capsule. Clinical features has the history that says the age. There is no age limit of the lipoma. It can occur in any age group, but the middle age group is more common. The duration is also the same. Means the lipoma is may present for years to a patient, and from months patient may have the unnoticed. So it may present for longer time, and the symptom is the only symptom in the lipoma is that a painless lump or the swelling. That is the only features. No pain should be there in the lipomas, and if no complication is there, till then the no pain should be there. In the later stage, when the lipoma attain a very big size, that in that condition it may present some pressure effects in the by compressing the surrounding structures, and so that in that condition if compressing any nerve, so that in that nerve some tingling sensation, some paresthesia may be there. No other symptoms is there, only the lump is there. On the examinations, the lipoma is mostly the position of the lipoma, that we already say it can present all over the body, but the most common place is the limbs, back of neck, back, and that trunk is the most common part. I think some person site for the multiple lipomatosis, and the solitary lipoma or the single lipoma is usually present on the back of neck. These has no tenderness, no pain until if any infection is there, in inflammation is there. So these are the body temperature, no not cold, not warm, just in the same as body temperature. No tenderness. Size and shape, there is no fixed size of the lipoma. It can attain from millimeters to centimeters. So it can attain a very big size also. The shape is not fixed. Sometimes it is very oval, sometimes it is lobulated, so it may present just like that, a bunch of that balloons. Sometimes it is the shape is also not very fixed. Means it cannot be triangle or square, but this is the means just like that. it can present as like the egg and sometimes the lobulated. Surface is always is smooth and poorly that border is not well defined, poorly defined border, but the surface is always is smooth. Consistency is usually soft until it get calcification. If it is any lipoma present for a very long time, so that in that condition it get calcifications. In that condition only the lipoma become hard. Otherwise lipoma, because it consists only the fat cells, that's why it is soft. Sometimes you may confuse any lipoma with a abscess, because that it may have some or the cyst, because it may have some fluctuation test positive there, because the fat cells are there only. So the fluctuation tests, sometimes fluctuations may be present in that lipoma. So you may have confused the lipoma with that cyst or the any abscess. So that's why you just rule out that other features. The trans illumination test is that when we throw light from one side of any mass and see the character of the light on the other side. So if you throw light on the one side of the lipomatous mass, so because there is a fat cells, so on the other side you can see you can see the light red colors. So that is the called trans illumination test. That is positive in the case when a cyst contain water or the serous material or the fats. So that's why trans illumination test is positive here. Mobility or slip sign is always positive. That is always character of the lipoma. This is how it will differentiate lipoma from cyst, that because that cyst are present in the skin, the dermoid cyst and sebaceous cyst. So in you cannot separate this cyst from the skin, means the skin over the mass. If it is movable, then it may not be cyst. The most chance will be there that swelling will be the lipoma, because the skin or the lipoma is not fixed, it is mobile. So the slip sign is always present in the case of the lipomas. So this is the feature of, this is the procedure of excision of the lipoma. Just first to identify, confirm the diagnosis, and just wrap the patients, clean that part, and give one linear incision over that mass. And the assistant should hold that mass under tension. So when you incise that skin, and you can found that you can found the capsule, and then you just separate it from it. It is very easily separated because it's not fixed, so it can easily separate it from that the surrounding tissue. And then you if it is, because it is very mobile, it is not fixed, so that's very difficult to hold. So you can put some stay sutures, because if you hold with the Allis forceps, so that because it is fat cells only, so it may rupture. So in that condition you can just hold that by the giving the stay sutures. Just put on one suture from in between the swelling, and you hold with this, and just give little traction and separate from that by the artery forceps all the suture, the sutures, insert the suture and open it. So just doing the blunt dissection, disconnect means just separate from that other tissue. It is very easily separable, and the large incision is not required, because when you just push in that surrounding, give little pressure and give the little traction at the same time, give the little traction to the mass, it will be very easy delivered from that opening. So after that removing that mass, just see the cavity. It should be means no mass should be left inside, and just clean the cavity, and if if there is any bleeding to the cauterization or that suturing, whatever means achieve, you have to achieve the hemostasis, stop the bleeding, and pour some local antibiotic solution. Then the closed cavity in that first give that inside the some with a catgut to close the collapse the cavity, and then you close the skin with the interrupted sutures and do the ESD. So this is the very simple procedure you can perform under local anesthesia. Usually general anesthesia is not required. You can perform that excision of the lipoma in very easily with the local anesthesia only. So this is the procedure of that excising this lipoma. So next, in the next class, we will just discuss the hemangioma.